Hi, I'm Mark Lewis, and I'm the author of Sword and Spear, which is a set of ancient and medieval wargames rules for fighting large battles on the tabletop. Also, we've just published Sword and Spear Fantasy as well, which is using the same mechanics as Sword and Spear, but obviously has fantasy elements added in as well. So, this is the first of a series of videos I'm going to be making telling you all about Sword and Spear. This first one is going to be an introduction, so I'm going to tell you about what you need to play, a little bit about basing and about the troop types, and then we're going to go on to look at having different videos to finding out all about combat, movement, shooting and all the other mechanics of the game. The idea is that you could watch these videos to find out if the game might be for you and if you've bought the game to actually help you learn how to play. The first few videos are all going to be focused on Sword and Spear, the historic rules, but they are going to be equally applicable to Sword and Spear Fantasy, because all of the rules in the historic game will also apply to the fantasy game. Then there'll be a few extra videos purely focusing on the extra elements in the fantasy rules. Okay, so first of all, what do you need to play Sword and Spear? Well, if we look around us here, you need a table, preferably with some sort of cloth or terrain features on it. We've got some terrain here, we've got a sort of area of rough ground here with a few palm trees on it. We've got a village and we've got a hill, so you need some terrain to make the battle more interesting. There are rules in the book for how to set up your table, and I'll be looking at those in a future video. You also need some figures. I've got some 28mm figures here, we've got some Scots and some Normans, and I've got some 15mm Macedonians here as well. Sword and Spear can be played with any scale figures, so I'm showing you two different scales here. It's a unit-based game, so the figures are organised into units. So as just as an example here, if you look at these Macedonians, we've got a unit of elephants, a unit of pikemen, a unit of Thracian infantry, got a unit of heavy cavalry and a unit of light cavalry over here, and then we've got a general there as well. So one unit, as an example, these elephants, all the units have to have the same frontage. So normally in 15mm, we play with an 80mm frontage unit. So the frontage of this unit is 80mm. We can see that the frontage of all of the units is 80mm. These are actually, the figures I've got are based on 40mm wide bases. So I put two of those across to make an 80mm frontage unit. The Thracians here. So we've got four of the sort of DBX, WRG standard bases making up one unit here. The pikes have got six bases making up a unit because they're a deeper unit because they're a pike phalanx. Got my unit of cavalry here, again 80mm frontage, unit of light cavalry, and the generals on a smaller base. It doesn't really matter what size base the commanders are on, so they're on a smaller base. You can actually play with just having a 40mm frontage unit, so that could be one unit in itself, but normally we'd use 80mm for 15mm. If we go back over to the 28mm figures over here, as I said, we've got some Normans here, we've got some Norman spearmen, some Norman crossbowmen, and some knights. And then there's my Norman general. Now the frontages I use here for 28mm figures are 120mm, so each of these bases, I use these sabot bases here so the figures can come off to be used in skirmish games. So these are 120mm frontage units here, but you can use any size units. As long as all of your units in your army are the same frontage, you can use any size units and they can be played in any scale. I've got some Scots over here, I've got a unit of Scots spearmen and a unit of Scots archers there. We can see that there's more figures on the spearmen base because these are heavy foot and the archers are medium foot. Similarly, over here, back to my Normans, we've got heavy foot and medium foot crossbowmen. So as long as you can tell which is which, it doesn't really matter how many figures you put on a base, as long as you can tell the difference between your heavies and your mediums and any light foot you have as well. Again, general is on a smaller base. It could just be, there's a general, there's my Scots general, he's on a round base. It doesn't really matter what size base your commanders are on. So there's my Scots general there. Let's put him with the spearmen. Okay, so we need some figures to play. What else do we need? It's best to use measuring sticks. Now, all the measurements in Sword and Spear are given in distance units. The one distance unit is half the frontage of our unit. So we can see there, this is a two distance unit measuring stick. So if we put that across there, it's the same as the frontage of our unit. And we use these for measuring movement. I've actually made up a few different ones here because it's more convenient. So we know that, for example, my heavy foot would move two distance units, so I can put my measuring stick there when I want to move them and move them forward like that. Just makes it easy if we've got a few measuring sticks made in different lengths. Cavalry would move four distance units, so that'd be our move of our cavalry when we're using 120mm fronted units. I've got measuring sticks over here for my 15mm. These are ones I've made, but you can actually buy one of these, which is from Charlie Foxtrot Models, and it's a specially made sword and spear measuring stick. And it's actually, as well as having the distance units marked on here, it's actually got the movement rates and the shooting ranges for the different troop types on here. So it's a very convenient measuring stick because it's got a lot of the information on the actual stick, so that's very useful to have. Okay, what else do we need? We need some dice. We're going to need some dice for combat. We're going to need some dice for activating units, and they're going to go in this dice bag. Now, this is, I'll talk more about this later, but this is one of the unique mechanisms in Sword and Spear, this having this bag where you pull dice out of the bag to activate your units. So we actually need two sets of dice, one for each army. We need one dice per unit in the army, in different colours, but the same size dice, so that when we put our hand in the bag, we don't know which side we're pulling out, because we're going to be pulling these dice out during the turn. So we've got two different coloured dice for the two different armies. And then I've got some separate dice here that I would use for combat. Okay, so it's good to have some different coloured dice so you know you don't get them mixed up on the table. We also need a way of marking hits on the units. So units will take hits, which is effectively it's a measure of the losses, the morale, the lack of cohesion, as well as actual casualties on the unit. So we could use small dice, like these small dice beside a unit. So for example, if this unit of spearmen takes a hit, I could put this dice to a one next to the unit. Or we could use some other sort of measuring tokens like these. Again, these came with the measuring stick. These are little skulls with numbers on. So there's a number one for one hit, and we've got one there for two hits as well. So I use these now, and I put these by the units. If my unit's taken a hit, I put a little skull by it showing a one. Or you can use anything you like. You can use casualty markers. You might have casualty markers with little spaces for the dice on. You could even mark it on a roster that you keep separate if you don't like the clutter on the table. But you do need some way of marking your hits. So that is what you need to play. Okay, and now we're going to go and look a little bit more about the different troop types. Now I'm going to tell you about the troop types that we have in Sword and Spear. We have set up here a Macedonian army facing an Achaemenid Persian army. So I'm going to go through and talk through the different troop types, first of all in the Macedonians and then in the Persians. Firstly, we have some cavalry here. On the left, we've got some heavy cavalry, some heavy Alexandrian cavalry, and then we've got some elephants, got a unit of elephants. Then we've got 1, 2, 3, 4 units of pike phalanx. Now these are classed as heavy foot. To represent the fact that they're deeper, they're classed as large units. So they're large units of heavy foot, and they have shield wall, which is their armour capability, and they have pikes. So different troop types have different capabilities and characteristics within the game. Okay, next, over here we've got some medium foot. These are Thracians. They don't have any particular troop or weapon characteristics, they're just medium foot. We've got some more cavalry, so these are classed as cavalry. We've got some light horse, these are javelin armed light horse, and then we've got some light foot, again armed with javelins, ready to go into the rough terrain there where they'll feel safe. Now I'm going to talk you through the troop types in the Persian army here. In these two armies, we've actually got most of the troop types that appear in the game. So it's a good selection of troops to illustrate the different troop types. So starting from the Persian right, we've got some light cavalry here, again armed with javelins. We've got our Persian medium cavalry, they might be called, but they're just classed as cavalry. There's only two types of cavalry in the game, there's light horse and there's cavalry. Then we've got some medium foot. These are our sparabara, so they're medium foot, but they've got pavises, they're classed as, so they've got these large shields in the front rank. Then we've got some Persian hoplites, so these are heavy foot armed with spears. We've got our generals behind, so we've got three commanders here on the Persian side. We'd probably class this one as our general, and two captains. So there's the two different classes of commanders we have in the game. The generals have a bigger command radius. So generals and captains can influence their troops, make them perform better if they're actually with a unit of troops. And they have a command radius, and outside that command radius, troops are out of command. So you do need to be careful about where you put your generals, because it's quite easy to get troops out of command. Okay, going back along, we've got some more bow-armed medium foot here. And then we've got a unit of Persian Immortals, which again are bow-armed medium foot, but they would be better quality. And I'll talk about how that's reflected in the game shortly. And we've got some more cavalry here on the end. We've got a camp on either side as well, so here's our Persian camp. The camp isn't compulsory, but it does count as an extra unit and it's free, so it's generally useful to have a camp. It does give your army a benefit, but the downside is if your camp gets sacked, that can have a detrimental effect on the army as a whole. I'm now going to talk a little bit about troop characteristics. I've got an army list here. Now, this isn't for either of the armies at present on the table. This is actually from an army I used in a game last night. But I'm just using this to show the characteristics of the different troop types. You can get these army lists from, download them for free from the Sword and Spear website. And it's in an Excel spreadsheet, so you can use them to build up your own armies to any points value. So just as an example here, we've got lists of all our different troop types in this. This is an Arab army. We've got our characteristics, we've got our troop type, for example, cavalry or heavy foot. We've got our discipline rating. This discipline rating determines how well the troops operate, and the lower discipline rating is better. So the discipline rating can either be 3, 4 or 5. So 3 is the best, which is your higher quality, your elite troops. 4 is average, and 5 is the poorer quality troops. The strength rating is how many hits it takes to rout a unit, and also how many dice they get in combat, their base combat dice. So it's a general measure of the combat strength of the unit. We've got protection, which is how well armoured they are, which can be average, or it can be lacking protection if they've got little armour, or armoured or heavily armoured, or it can be shield wall for troops like hoplites that rely on their cohesion and shield wall. We've got any missile capabilities, for example bows, javelins. We've got melee capabilities, so we've got some who have spears. There are other melee capabilities as well, like pikes, impact for lancer cavalry or warband type troops. We can have other characteristics such as undrilled for troops that aren't very well trained. And then we've got a points, how many points they cost if we're playing to an equal points game. For example, this army here is a total of 350 points. And then we have something called army value, which is to determine victory and defeat. It's how valuable those troops are to the army. Those are totaled up to give a total army value for the army, and later on I'll talk about how that affects the outcome of the battle. This is here really is for building your army, some guidelines for how many troops you should have in your army. So that's the sort of typical army list, and I'll just give a couple of examples of some of the troops that we've got here on the battlefield. So we have our light horse here. These are strength 2. All skirmishes are strength 2, which means it takes 2 hits to kill the to defeat the unit, to rout the unit, and they fight with 2 combat dice in battle or if they're shooting. We've got our cavalry here. These are strength 3. These are discipline 3 cavalry because they're elite Alexandrian cavalry, and they are they could be armoured or average. I think those ones would be armoured. They've got some metal armour, so those would be armoured, and they would have the impact ability because they are armoured lancers. We've got our Thracians here, also strength 3. So cavalry, medium foot, strength 3. Our Thracians don't have any other characteristics apart from maybe they'd be undrilled. Discipline 4, so they're average troops. We've got our heavy foot here. Now these ones are discipline 3, those are our elite phalanx. The others are all discipline 4. They've got the shield wall protection characteristic, and they've all got pikes and they're large units. Now, elephants are strength 3, they have armour, they're effectively counted as armoured, they have the impact characteristic, so they're very effective when they charge. They have some other special abilities as well, which we'll talk about later. And again, these cavalry here, again, we're Discipline 3, they're high quality cavalry. We've got no Discipline 5 troops in this army, no poor quality troops, but there could well be some in the Persian army that they're facing, but all Discipline 4 and 3. Okay, so that's given a little bit of an introduction into the game, what you need, what the armies are made up of, what a battle looks like, certainly to start with. And in later videos, I'll be talking about the turn sequence, how to set up the game, how activation of units works, how units move and fight and shoot, and how a game is won or lost. Bye for now.